Saratu Atta and Napanga Tiasule Mana will serve as presidential staffers. Nana Akufo-Addo has also appointed Brigadier General Emmanuel Autry as a National Security Advisor, and Mr. Joshua Chiremi will serve as the National Security Coordinator. According to the President-elect, matters of security will be paramount under his presidency. Therefore, he has appointed former Minister for the Interior and Defense in President Akufo-Addo's administration, Mr. Albert Kandapa, as the Minister for National Security.
These are the appointments that have been announced, and they will get to work immediately on the 7th of January for us to begin this Akufo-Addo mandate. So, thank you very much for coming, and there'll be other announcements and other occasions for me to be talking to you. Thank you very much.
The incoming Chief of Staff, Madame Frimol Pariose, was optimistic that the appointees have the right skills to run the administrative work and the organization of the presidency.
In terms of managing people, in terms of strategy development, in terms of development work, which is what governance is all about, improving lives of the people, I feel ready in terms of the all-round skills that I bring on board. Since, I would say, September 2013, I've been coordinating Nana's political affairs until today. So I am happy to accept the position. I feel ready. All I need is your cooperation and, most importantly, your prayers.
These individuals are the first official appointees of the Akufo-Addo's government, and their work starts right after the investiture of the president-elect on the 7th of January 2017.
Still on Wednesday, President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo met President John Mahama at the Flagstaff House. In a little more than 70 hours from now, power will change hands between the two gentlemen. The meeting afforded Nana Akufo-Addo and the incoming Vice President Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia the opportunity to confer, and for the incoming officials to familiarize themselves with offices within the seat of government. Napoleon Atukito reports.
Ghana's incoming president, Nana Akufo-Addo, stepped his foot at the seat of government, the Flagstaff House, with a comment, "This is my first time of coming to the Flagstaff House." He has been given the nod by the electorate after his third attempt at the presidential seat. He was accompanied by the vice president-elect, Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia. The two were welcomed by outgoing president, John Mahama, and his vice, Power Kwesi Emisa Afa. Their meeting reflected the transition period, with each side commending the other for their political maturity and polite submission and respect throughout the process.
Let me thank you for the cooperation we've had. I believe that with every step that we take in respect of our elections and transition of power, it consolidates further Ghana's democratic credentials, and all of us, you know, both incoming and outgoing administration, can take a pride that Ghana has become synonymous with democracy, not only in Africa, but I guess the whole world. And I believe that the cooperation that we have shown each other in terms of the transition process is one that should continue. I have said before that Ghana's success is all our success, and we need to work to ensure that government is a continuum and that we continue to build on whatever an outgoing government leaves and another government comes and takes over and builds on it. Governments will come and go, but Ghana must continue to progress.
First of all, let me thank you for the courtesy of this visit. I know how pressed you are, if you've been able to find time to go through this such a formality, but an important formality. I think that what the world has seen, what we ourselves are actors in, is the continuity of our institutions in Ghana. And that is a matter that should give a great deal of comfort and reassurance, first of all, to our own population and people. And the democratic edifice that we have built continues to be solidified and consolidated. It is extremely important for the future of our country. for those of us who are called upon to play leadership roles in that journey, show the spirit that you have shown ever since the result of this election became clear. It is to your credit, and at the appropriate time, the Ghanaian people will honor you for the grace and the dignity with which you've accepted what happened on the 7th of December.
After their meeting, the visiting delegation led by President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo was taking round various departments of the Flagstaff House. Among the officers they visited were the President's own office, officers of the Vice President, the ceremonial room, and large delegation meeting room. They were also at the official residence of the President on the same compound. President John Mahama hardly used the facility. He also conducted official business there when he received international observer missions to the December 7th elections on the eve of the event. On account of that elections, President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo won a clear mandate from the people in whom popular sovereignty resides. Napoleon Atukitu reporting.
Meanwhile, the Ghana Pentecostal and Charismatic Council on Tuesday called on the President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo at his Nima residence in Accra. At the center of the deliberations was how the council can work with the incoming government to implement policies and programs to improve the lot of Ghanaians. The President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo gave an assurance that he will offer a purposeful leadership aimed at bolstering the economic transformation of the country.
According to the Ghana Pentecostal and Charismatic Council, anyone elected to the high office of the President of Ghana needs to be supported both spiritually and physically. Therefore, their visit to the President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo was to pledge their support to him and his government. He also prayed for Nana Akufo-Addo for God's guidance, strength, wisdom and divine knowledge as he takes over the mantle of leadership on Saturday. The President of the Ghana Pentecostal and Charismatic Council, Apostle Dr. Opoku Onyina, led the delegation.
We, as part of the spiritual leaders of God's flock in the nation, pledge our prayer and moral support to you as you seek the welfare of the state. And in fact, it is our duty to pray for whoever is in government. The Bible actually challenges us and instructs us to pray for leaders. We will, however, not fail to draw your attention to issues that we need to do so. Together, we shall seek the progress and prosperity of the nation.
The President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo said the MPP government under his leadership has one agenda, and that is to make life better.
I'm hoping to do a good job for the people that is coming to this school as clean a heart as possible. I think that the Ghanaian people have tremendous potential. Purposeful needs. That potential can be exploited to bring about progress and prosperity.
Nana Adodankwa Akufo-Addo will on Saturday 7th January be sworn in as the next president of Ghana.
President John Mahama will deliver his final State of the Nation's address to Parliament on Thursday, January 5, 2017. The address, a constitutional requirement, was originally slated for Thursday, December 22, 2016, but was rescheduled. President Mahama's address will herald the end of the sixth parliament of the Fourth Republic, which will be dissolved officially on Friday, January 6. The Deputy Director of Public Affairs of Parliament, Kate Addo, told journalists in Accra that on Friday at midnight, the sixth parliament will come to an end.
Ah.
Parliament today, Wednesday, 4th January, was in session, but most of its proceedings were done in corridors after the Speaker of Parliament called for a one-hour break. Among the issues which were to be put before the House included a report on the loan agreement between the Government of Ghana and the Africa and Middle East Resources Investment Group for the repowering and operation of the T3 power plant. GBC24 spoke to the executives of the Senior Staff Association of the Volta River Authority who were in Parliament to protest against the Ameri deal. We'll bring you pictures to that story later. In the just ended 2016 general elections, the number of women in Parliament has increased from 29 to 37. In this report, we look at the results, the challenges, the roles, the plans and expectations of these women leaders.
In a country where women outnumber men, making up 51% of the total population and the economy relatively driven by them, what generally is expected is more women at the decision-making table. But this is not the case, despite calls by various women's organizations and the Gender Ministry for a higher representation of women in leadership roles. The situation virtually remains the same. The Director of Policy Planning, Monitoring and Evaluation at the Ministry of Defense, Mrs. Catherine Apiapinkra, said the percentage of women in Parliament is still not encouraging.
When the ministry was established, I remember we said we wanted at least 30%. At least, let's get closer to 15-20 and then we go up. We haven't reached anywhere, not even half of what we projected. And I think that, I don't want to call it a failure, but I think that there's something that we need to do that we are not doing right. And this is about time. And I put a challenge to the new female parliamentarians that we voted in power to take up this mantle. My worry is those who didn't win, that they should not worry at all. It is a battle. Some will win, some will, but they should come up quickly. They should not relent. They should quickly do their homework and then bounce back.
She mentioned lack of funding, grooming and public misconception as some of the challenges female parliamentarians face.
When governments come, they do well in filling positions with women. That area, we are comfortable. It's coming up. But when it comes to Parliament, we need permanent seats there. Apart from us pushing the affirmative action, I also plead that maybe those in positions that can look at the quota system should look at that. And again, let's also look at best practices. And from now, let's start our job. If we can also have tete-a-tete with the political parties, we will plead with them to look at the safe seats when it comes to the primaries, not the general election. When it comes to the primaries, they should make sure that at least they can even let two women even contest. There is a need for us to groom our women, those who are already in and those who are coming.
The female parliamentarians who got elected in the December polls shared their views on how these challenges can be curtailed.
There should be more advocacy for funding for women parliamentarians because the playing field is never the same. So I always say that the media has a role to play in changing public perception. That's where the issue is. It may not be with the women themselves, but public perception has created the space where the woman is not some women are not confident. Not because they can't be confident, but then the public will say, oh, you're a woman too, you are going to do this, that kind of a thing. So those are the issues that if we have the perceptions changed, I'm sure more women will be comfortable to stand for public office.
We can't continue to lower filing fees and hope that that would help. So far, we've tried that over two election cycles. It hasn't helped improve the numbers significantly. So all parties and the entire country has to start thinking of what strategies we can put in place. One, two, and I've been saying this over and over and over again. We need to start identifying potential women leaders early. we're going to get a group of younger female MPs in the House. And we all need to know how to deal or handle, work with them, the fairly younger female legislators that we're going to be having in the House. We may, I'm not saying we will, but the men need to be helped to know how to relate better to the female legislators.
There are still a lot outside who want to be part, but they are afraid. Why? Because of sometimes women politicians are being tagged to be flirts in common, and then others say when you are even a married woman, you become a politician, it's likely you are to be divorced. And then a whole lot, especially the support, financially support, that people think if you are a woman, you don't get when you are a woman politician. I will encourage them that they shouldn't look at all those things. When you go to other countries, they say this seat is for women. They have a percentage that are for women. And no man goes there. It's only for a woman and nothing else. I think when Ghana will also implement that, we'll get to where we want to go.
The MP for Ablekuma West, Mrs. S. Lewusu Ekufo, said the affirmative action for women introduced by the NPP must be adopted nationally.
I urge the NPP and all other parties to revisit the attempt they made at affirmative action for women. We can't just pay lip service to equal opportunities to women when the deck is stacked against us and we are coming from a disadvantaged position and expected to compete on the same terms as the men. They hold some of us up as examples of people who have fought and survived. I don't want anybody to go through the experiences that I have been through. It takes too much out of you.
They stated that they play a crucial role as women in parliament.
Women generally are better leaders. Not because of themselves, but I think they are created with the capacity of being multitasked, or being able to bear more, or being able to understand more, and being able to put themselves in other people's shoes. So I'm just saying Ghanaians should give women a chance.
Women without us, nothing can work. I keep saying that we are, if you're a right-handed person, we are the right hand, because quietly we do what we have to do without seeking any praise or anything, because there's a job which needs to be done. Nobody or not many people recognize the contributions that women make to the legislature, to the executive, to the society generally. They were just taken for granted that we will do what we have to do, and we don't really matter. But without us, then people will see how much of a lack society is suffering if we do not encourage women to also assist the men wherever they are.
Generally, people expect these female parliamentarians to exhibit more empathy towards the needs of their constituents.
As a woman, you can actually meet their emotional needs more than any other person can, because you are a mother, you understand their feelings.
They're coming to you not just with the school fees, the medical bills, the rent, the job applications. That's normal. Every MP gets that. But you're having to deal with marital issues as well. You're having to deal with problems they have with their children.
What I did previously for them to appreciate and even vote for me, such a manner, I think I have to maintain, even do more. And it has been my prayer.
These women parliamentarians were very grateful for all the support they received and were optimistic of making a positive change in their various constituencies.
The leadership of the National Democratic Party, NDP, is calling on the incoming government of Nana Akufo-Addo to prosecute all corruption cases. The party promised to cooperate in every effort to rid the nation of corruption.
Addressing the press, the general secretary of the party, Alhaji Mohammed Frimpong, said, as a political party, the NDP in the run to the 2016 elections sought for a change in government, and that has been achieved, though the party did not win. He said, the change should be for all. Alhaji Mohammed Frimpong commended the incoming administration's move to set up an independent office to handle all corrupt cases.
The NDP shall continue to be the beacon of unalloyed social democracy and in the pursuit of the fundamental goals of the 1992 constitutional democracy. We add our voice to the demand of the nation on the president-elect to prosecute robustly every case of corruption already on earth and to be on earth.
The flag bearer of the party, Nana Kunedu Ajimai Rawlings, said, given only 26 days to campaign, the NDP toured the length and breadth of the nation and was confident that Ghanaians needed a change considering the hardship a lot of mothers were going through. She emphasized the need to give the new administration a chance to fulfill its promises.
We wanted this change for all Ghanaians. We were not looking for change because we thought we would be given positions. No, we've seen the change. We want to see that change manifest itself to improved lives, improved livelihoods in Ghana.
The party promised to support the NPP administration when the need arises. The party commended Ghanaians for a successful elections.
The ultimatum given to the Association of State Attorneys to return to work expired on Tuesday, 3rd January 2017. A letter from the Ghana Legal Service Board earlier warned that if the strike was not called off, it would amount to vacation of posts. But members of the association are still on strike, which began in October 2016. The strike action was as a result of the government's failure to meet their demands for improved conditions of service.
The Association of State Attorneys have been on strike for over 3 months. The reason for the strike is for an improved condition of service. They include the provision of vehicles, harmonized salaries, sustainable pension schemes, and logistical support. Via petition to the Ministry of Finance, the Justice and Attorney General's Department, and the Fair Wages and Salaries Commission has still yielded no results. The Public Relations Officer for the Ministry of Justice and Attorney General's Department, Mr. Ebenezer Usuansa, mentioned that the Ghana Legal Service Board ordered the association to go back to work by Tuesday, January 3, 2017. According to a letter by the Legal Service Board, failure to do so would result in authorities considering the absence as a vacation of posts.
And a normal HR practice, if you don't come to work for a while, I think it's 10 days. After 10 days, it's considered that you have vacated your post. And that is what the legal board has written to them. So it would be wise for them to come back to work. The way that they are going about it, they expect everything instantly, and it's not possible. Things will not happen that way, in my opinion. It's not everything that they will get. So they should be prepared for a win-win situation.
As at 11 a.m. on Wednesday, January 4, none of the members of the association had reported to work. A man who spoke off camera said they are not back because they have not heard anything from the board about their concerns. Mr. Ebenezer Ogusanza asked the association to exercise patience with government in the process of solving their problems. He added that negotiations are still ongoing to meet some of their demands.
About 1.5 months after President John Mahama inaugurated the Kwame Nkrumah Circle Interchange, one of his signature projects, GBC24 this morning did a sightseeing around the complex road network.
GBC24 has been monitoring activities at the Kwame Nkrumah Interchange after it was inaugurated a few months ago. Many people had mixed feelings about whether this national landmark would be spared the indiscipline of some pedestrians and traders. Lo and behold, itinerant traders have returned to the pavement along the interchange doing brisk business. The traders range from those dealing in herbal medicine to roasted corn and plantain vendors. Another thing that caught the attention of the news team was that containers provided for waste collection were overflowing with garbage and are left unattended to. There is also a bit of human traffic between the pedestrian walkway and the loading point for the Metro Mass Transit buses. Luckily, there is a traffic control team directing pedestrians and vehicles to ensure free movement.
You're still watching News Hour on GBC24 and GTV. We have the business news coming up shortly. Please stay with us. Good evening and welcome. Time now for business, and I'm Dorothy Adjumine. The first fuel pricing window for the month of January has seen some oil marketing companies increase their pump prices by over 9%, meaning a gallon of petrol now sells at over 18.67 cedis from the previous 17.05 Ghana cedis per gallon. The jumping price has been attributed to an increase in oil price of international markets and the depreciation of the cedi to the dollar. A barrel of crude oil now sells at around $54.
The latest increment is coming on the heels of the most recent increases from the previous window of December 16th that saw between 4 to 6% hikes due to the poor performance of the cedi and world market prices having shot up from around $51 to $56 a barrel at the time. The cedi over the past 2 weeks has further depreciated by about 2.68% to currently trade at 4 cedis 20 pesos to the US dollar from the previous 4 cedis 10 pesos to the dollar. Pump prices as at Wednesday, 4th January 2017, has gone up by over 9% from some of the major oil marketing companies, though the majority are yet to do any adjustments. Deregulation of the downstream oil market has given oil marketing companies the power to review prices every 2 weeks. Prices are either reduced or increased based on the strength of the local currency and the price of oil on the international market.
The DVLA has begun registration of vehicles for the year with high turnouts as usual. Authorities say the process has so far been free of challenges in spite of the huge numbers at the various centers.
Vehicle owners who purchased their cars within the last few months of the year prefer to register them in the ensuing year. The backlog creates congestion at the DVLA offices throughout the country at the beginning of every year. A visit to the DVLA headquarters in Accra revealed that although the turnout is high, a system put in place by the authority ensures that only persons who started the registration process last year get the opportunity to fully register their vehicles this year.
We encouraged people to do their inspections at the last quarter of last year so that it can bring down the number of people who would have gone to the inspection center the first day, and also reduce the number of people who have come to us the first working day of 2017. So that is why you don't see the place a bit very busy or cumbersome, because a lot of people had done or listened to the advice and they did their inspections. So all they need is just to bring the paper and then take their numbers after payments.
Michael Lai is a driver. He has been waiting from 6 a.m. for his vehicle to be registered. He tells GBC24 that although the process is an improvement over previous years, it has been stressful.
It's very stressful. I came to meet a lot of people. In fact, the queue was very, very long when I came at 6 a.m. I was told last year was very, very tough than this year. So I know people has gone to so many places, so it isn't like before.
Over the years, DVLA has experienced a 10% growth in vehicle registration and registers 150 to 200 vehicles daily. The authority is, however, registering 300 vehicles per day this year. The authority is assuring customers of quality service, adding that measures are in place for a hassle-free registration process.
The first week in 2017 has seen the Ghana cedi dipping in value to the US dollar and other major trading currencies. The local currency is now trading at 4 cedis 20 pesos on the interbank market and 4 cedis 25 pesos at the Forex Bureau in Accra. The development comes on the heels of a fairly stable performance of the cedi against the dollar in the third quarter of 2016.
The Ghana cedi has been fairly stable in the second and third quarters of 2016, recording about 1% depreciation against the US dollar, the largest traded foreign currency in Ghana. Comparatively, the cedi slumped 17% against the US dollar in 2015 from an opening of 3 cedis 20 pesos to the US dollar. The performance of the cedi was not any better in 2014 when it slumped by 21%. It also recorded 9% drop in 2012. However, the performance of the local currency in the third quarter of 2016 convinced the central bank that the cedi will further stabilize against the dollar. But 2 days into the new year, the cedi is struggling to hold its own against the US dollar and other foreign currencies. Before the dawn of the Christmas festivities, the cedi was selling at 3 cedis 50 pesos to the US dollar, 4 cedis 50 pesos to the pound sterling, and 4 cedis to the euro. But when the news queue hit the Oxford Street at Osu on Tuesday morning, customers could change their dollars at 4 cedis 30 pesos and 4 cedis 25 pesos on the black market. At the Forex Bureaus, customers could buy the dollar at 4 cedis 40 pesos and 4 cedis 30 pesos and also sell their dollars to these bureaus at 4 cedis 10 pesos and 4 cedis 15 pesos. Kweku Asante Ado at Penta Forex Bureau on the Oxford Street said the prices have been fairly stable until yesterday.
It was moving around 3, 5 and 4 and it went up 4, 1 in 4, 1. Sometimes you can give 4, 2 to customers based on if you have orders to sell.
As of today, the dollar to the city, how much are you?
I am buying dollar at 4.1 and I'm selling at 4.3 as of today.
And then is it the price that cuts across all the Forex Bureaus or is
I can't see, but I can see that from my street, Oxford Street. You see, every morning we call each other to find out how the prices are. Most of the time it's determined by us. So on the Oxford Street, maybe I'll call the next Forex Bureau, the other one will call me. And we'll come to a conclusion on the rate.
He attributed the rapid depreciation of the cedi to the US dollar to the springing up of black markets in the capital.
This is the black market is forcing the thing too much, so I think they have to take them. They are all over, they are just moving around. A customer will come and give black market rate. So you are forced to sometimes buy and follow a little margin. But when they are checked, we all just stood the line. Maybe we want to put it at 4. Is it possible? Everybody knows that when you come to Oxford Street, it is 4. When I go the next bureau, it is 4. The next one is 4. Mine is 4. They will change. But when black market guy is walking around easily, freely, and he's giving 4-2, they will not come to Oxford Bureau. And once sometimes a customer will come and complain that he got 4-2, so I will force to also do that for the customer. We push the thing up, making the city weaker.
Operator of Quick D Exchange on the Oxford Street, who chose to speak on the condition of anonymity, blamed the plummeting of the city to the black market. On the other hand, the Forex Bureaus are selling the pound sterling at 5 cedis 20 pesos, buying at 5 Ghana cedis. They are also buying the euro at 4 cedis 20 pesos and selling it at 4 cedis 40 pesos.
And now back to our earlier story. Parliament today, Wednesday, 4th January, was in session, but most of its proceedings were done in corridors after the Speaker of Parliament called for a one-hour break. Among the issues which were to be put before the House included a report on the loan agreement between the Government of Ghana and the Africa and Middle East Resources Investment Group
for the repowering and operation of the T3 power plant.
For the 22nd sitting of the third meeting of Parliament, although some members of both the majority and minority were available for proceedings to commence, the session stalled after an hour break. Ahead of the dissolution of the 6th Parliament of the 4th Republic, some outgoing members of Parliament who were spotted were Hannah Tete, Alhaji Sorogo, Okiti Dria, E.T. Mensah, Rahel Apo, among others. Also at the public gallery were the executives of the Senior Staff Association of the Volta River Authority, who were present to demand an abrogation of the Africa and Middle East Resource Investment Ameri deal with the government of Ghana. In an interview with GBC24, the chairman of the Senior Staff Association of the Volta River Authority, Cephas Duse, said the Ameri deal to undertake retrofit and ancillary work on the T3 will result in an eventual takeover of the plant, which would drastically reduce the output of the company.
We sell our power in the local currency CD, but this IP, when they come in, they sell their power into us in what, foreign currency. It exposes us to what, foreign currency exposure. Anytime the CD depreciates, it means that for the same amount of what, power sold, you have to look for more CD to be able to pay, because the CD had just what, depreciated. And then let me also just add that the IPP, one risk involved with them is that you will pay capacity charges. That is, that if they are available and you don't use them, you have to pay for it. And as we speak, for the current deal, we are to pay $2.3 million every month. Multiply that by 12 and multiply that by 4. It tells you the quantum of money that we have to cough out.
Mr. Cephas Duse, however, added that instead of government's move to encourage Ameri to take over the operation of the T3 power plant, it should rather consider fuel and funds to assist VRA in fixing the plant.
And most of the time, VRA is made as what, an off-taker. If you're an off-taker, it means that we buy the power from what? We buy the power from Ameri at a higher tariff, let's say 15. We sell to the public around less than 6 cents per kilowatt hours. So for every power that we buy, it negatively impact on our operation, because we are buying at a higher price and we are selling at a weighted average price of what, 6. And so for every product you buy, you incur some loss in there.
Meanwhile, the House is preparing for President Mahama's last State of the Nation address on Thursday, 5th January. For GBC24, Ofriwa Dako reporting.
You're watching the business segment of the news. Moving on, all interbank markets, the pound is selling at 5 cedis 15 pesos, the US dollar at 4 cedis 20 pesos, and the euro is also trading at 4 cedis 37 pesos. On the commodities market, light crude is trading at $52.69 per barrel and cocoa at $2,188 per ton. Gold is also going for $1,164.60 an ounce. And that's it for business. Health segment is next.
The Nursing and Midwifery Council of Ghana has employed students
student nurses to approach their job with professionalism, enthusiasm, love for human lives, and above all, the spirit of service without reward. The Upper East Regional Officer of the Council, Mrs. Rebecca Puganga, who gave the advice, also encouraged the students to emulate the example of the pioneers in the profession who delivered humane and godly care to patients.
The Zwarugu Nursing Training College in the Upper East Region first started as Bolgatanga Health Assistance Training School in November 2006. The college runs a two-year program split into four semesters. Until it was moved to Zwarugu, the school had been operating on the premises of the Bolgatanga Nursing Training College in a single classroom and using a store as an office. It started with an initial intake of 50 students, but currently has a student population of 911. For the institution, 10 years is a time for deep and sober reflection of its mission in how to develop and enhance the capacities of frontline health workers. The Regional Officer of Nursing and Midwifery Council of Ghana, Mrs. Rebecca Puganga, encouraged the students to uphold the dignity of the profession.
Teachers and students must come to the school at the fifth hour every day and observe the rules of the institution. One cannot go into a hospital at hours when visitors cannot allow.
The climax of the 10th anniversary witnessed the commission of a new classroom block for the school. The principal of the school, Mr. Michael Idana Mantamia, congratulated the founding fathers and stakeholders who have contributed in diverse ways to the growth and development of the college. He seized the opportunity to solicit support for the construction of a befitting auditorium for the college.
International news is next. Welcome to this segment. The Ghana Football Association has confirmed the calendar for the 2016-2017 football season at its extraordinary congress in Accra. The GFA president, Mr. Kwesi Nyantichi, revealed that the 2016-2017 Ghana Premier League will kick off in February, on the 4th of February 2017, while the GM Bank Division 1 League will kick off on February 3rd, 2017. That's it for sports.
Time for the arts news. My name is Valerie Danso. The arts desk interacted with artisans at the Arts Center in Accra to find out the expectations for the new year. Though they complained of low sales in 2016, they are hopeful that 2017 will bring good tidings. The Ghana National Fire Service held its annual WASA to usher in the new year. They were reminded of their mandate to prevent and manage fires in the country.
The annual get-together by the Ghana National Fire Service is a time to make merry, interact and socialize after a hectic year's work. The Fire Vibration Group of the Fire Service sets the ball rolling with an anthem. The Fire Service Council Chairman, Kenneth Drassa, mentioned some successes chalked up over the years, but added that there is more room for improvement.
The frontiers of fire safety have been extended through the establishment of well-equipped fire stations across the country, and the average citizen is gaining a greater understanding and appreciation of the role of the fireman within his community. The Home Fire Safety Program, being introduced by the service, holds the key to a drastic reduction in the disturbing phenomenon of increases in domestic fires. The response time to fire grounds has improved considerably. There is more room for improvement.
Some deserving officers were awarded. The end of year party ended with the live band music from the Vibration.
That's all in this segment. Have a good evening.
Watching the weather report right here only on GTV.
To end the news, a look once again at the main points. President Mahama has officially welcomed President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo to the Flagstaff House. The visit was to enable the incoming president to familiarize himself with his soon-to-be office. Nana Addo was accompanied by Vice President-elect Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia and other key party officials.
President-elect Nana Akufo-Addo has announced more appointments for the incoming NPP administration. Madam Akosua Fimo-Pariose will serve as the chief of staff and will be assisted by two deputies.
And that's all in the news for now. Thank you so much for watching.
We'll bring you news tonight at 10:30. Please make a date.
Good evening.